The terminal is by far the best option when manipulating data in the command line, but it's only as good as the user who's operating it. So instead of becoming the impossible expert at every possible tool you can imagine, we're going to use a simple trick to unlock hacker productivity in just a few minutes. I spent years perfecting my CLI game, but here's the one pro that taught me how to really improve. This is Jay. He hacked Chrome last year and got paid over $15,000 for his findings. Now, he didn't take over the company or threw Sundar Pichai off his chair, but he did find a very interesting chain of security vulnerabilities. Since Google, Jay managed to hack both Uber twice and find a huge bug in the Airbnb system. So how did he manage to run all those hacks? It's about speed and efficiency, specifically when using the command line.
Just grabbing text of a huge blob can be one of the most frustrating things you can do. It's basically finding a needle in a haystack. Well, introducing Grep.
The widely known method for using grep over a file is cutting the file and piping that to grep. This is commonly known as cat abuse. There's no actual reason to do that. Please comment if you think otherwise. Grep can take the file as an input, and there's no reason for another process here. So grepping the word one followed by the file achieves the same result with slightly less resources and much less to remember. Now for another common use, a blob of text, not necessarily structured, coming back from an API, in this case Kubernetes, but this is just an example. Piping to grep here makes a lot of more sense, and it can easily filter what you're looking for with very little brain power. The thing is, as simple as it is, you get all of your appearances of the string with not too many ways of filtering it, at least not in the context of the simple usage. As you can see, grep is case sensitive by default, and this is the first key thing to remember about it. So if I were to grep subresource and I'd like it to appear even without the accurate case, I can turn grep to be case insensitive by just adding minus I. The other key flag is the reverse flag. That negates the search string and prints all the lines that don't have it within them by adding minus phi. This of course works in tandem with case insensitivity flag, and that's really all you need to know and remember about grep. Minus I for case insensitivity and minus V for reversing the results.
When working with structured data like JSON or YAML, it can get unbelievably annoying when you want to get a certain field. Writing a script for that is sometimes somewhat of an overkill. What if you only want to get just a nested string? Well, in comes JQ.
Let's use the same Kubernetes API to get ourselves a JSON example. So basically, I'm asking for the system to structure my data to my preference, which is very conventional. Specifically, JSON is a great option for many reasons, but just getting it plainly in the CLI looks like a bunch of text with braces and commas. To fix that, let's pipe everything into JQ, the JSON query tool. Out of the box, you get syntax highlighting, which is already 80% of the work when it comes to visually processing the information. Just pipe into JQ and you get yourself some structure. However, it can do more, much more. We're only scratching the surface today, but JQ comes with the simplest query language you can think of. Simply add a dot, which is the conventional notation for an internal field, the name of the field, and you've got yourself the answer isolated. Now, JQ, of course, can access a list of types, not only nested objects. To do that, let's grab an example list. To access a certain field, just like with any other language, just add the index inside a pair of square brackets and let JQ do its thing. A nice touch is that you can also leave it empty to grab all the elements, which is great both for concatenating lists and when you have a deeper nested object, you can get them all in one bulk. Well, what if you want the same thing but for a YAML file? Incoming YQ, the lesser known smaller brother of JQ. So let's get the same response as YAML, same as with JQ, just piping to YQ gives you the syntax highlighting. And using the same language, we can access nested fields within a YAML structure. So for the sake of example, let's access the status object. And within the status object, we have two fields, status and storage size. Let's try to grep storage size, for example, and there you go. YQ has another cool feature where it can replace data on the fly. Adding an equal notation with the new value spits it right out. This works well both for numbers as well as strings. And if I were to change something like the entire status object, just deciding that status is now something, I can do that and it works just as well. Lastly, an important tip. With one flag, and that's the only flag you should remember, it'll convert a plain JSON to YAML. Check this out, minus POY, which I remember as print out YAML, and you get your data ready to go. Just to confirm the structure, let's do the stupidest loop ever done, a one-liner that converts JSON to YAML to just pipe it to YQ instead of JQ. When things get messy, remember you can always use JQP. Last golden tip for the XQ users out there. These JQ slash YQ queries can get annoying with large sets of data, and they can get quite expensive, both in time and in effort for the system that fetches them. Imagine getting back a set of 1,000 machines from AWS, each in a JSON of 100 lines. There's a toll on the system, your terminal, and maybe even your monthly cloud bill. You could solve that by simply writing to a file, but you still rerun the queries. So in comes JQP. JQP takes the output and dynamically changes the query as you move along. It opens a simple three panes UI with a query line, a source, and a result that you can move between with vMotions and follow your work. Exactly like working with JQ in the command line, I can get status.status and get the entry itself, or I can change that on the fly to something else like the storage size and get that. Or if I can see the API version, for example, in my source pane to the left, I can just retype that and get the result to the right. And again, you can scroll through with vMotions, fetch other data, read the fields that you're trying to get, and maybe then rewrite your query to something else you're looking for, like the metadata and the creation time step within that. This is so powerful, I almost always find myself just going straight to JQP instead of just piping to JQ because of the comfort and the ease of reading data and manipulating it straight away. So what happens if you got all your data parsed, colored, and even got the field that you need, but now you need to make changes in the output fields, like add a prefix, or change the case, or delete certain characters? In comes SED, the Stream Editor CLI. Now, before getting into SED, let's just mention something very important. SED has a few different flavors. I'm not sure why, but the Mac version, for example, isn't identical to the Linux one. Maybe for simplicity, but when you use it locally on a Mac, for example, and you expect it to work similarly on a remote machine, it many times won't. I spent a few dozens of hours of my life puzzled at the weird results in the past, so keep in mind and install GNU SED if you want the full compatibility. For demonstration, I'll actually use the Mac one and we'll shortly compare them. SED syntax is a replace query, as much as you know from Vim, switch, separator, source, separator, target, and then another separator, which I, from habit, close it with a G for global. Note that SED works on the incoming stream and doesn't write the changes anywhere. You can see that the replace string appears on the left on the stream, but if I reread the file to the right, it's not there. Nothing's been written. If we do want changes to be written, there are two options. Directly writing to a file, like I'm doing right now, where we can now see that the file actually holds the changes, or the dangerous alternative of writing in place. Why dangerous, you ask? Let's try to take the result and rewrite the original file. I'm ended up with an empty file. This is part of the reasons you may want to use GNU SED, where it's easy to add a minus I for in-place replacement, and that's the only flag you need to remember, and this will update the file. So GNU SED, minus I, same string, and I can rewrite the file in place. Now that's done, let's read the file, and the changes are there. Lastly, what if we want to make the same changes with SED, but not have them applied globally on the file, as they are by default? Let's pipe the file to bat for a quick show of the line numbers, and let's say that I want only line 4 to be switched over. I simply added 4 before the search query, before the S, and as easy as that, line 4 is only replaced at this time. This is especially useful when combined with a loop. Let's say you want to iterate through the lines and only to make changes based on a certain logic, maybe only odd numbers or based on a more complicated entry. Well, it's extremely useful to memorize the bash loop exactly for these scenarios. A one-liner can get you a very long way. The syntax goes while read minus R for recursively a line or any other var name, do the logic and done. That's it. That's all you have to remember. Now for the sake of example, let's run a command and replace all the O's with 1, 2, 3. Not an excellent change, but it works.
Everything I shared until now is great when the data is structured. What happens if some kind of a system just shoots at you a mumble of unstructured data and you need to read something or try to get something out of it? In comes pagers. Linux has a few, there's more and there's less. Those are two of the more common names. And all you have to do is pipe your request into the pager and then just read on. The pager makes it digestible and maneuverable, so you can use your vMotions to slowly move across or jump to the start, jump to the end, etc. If you need the extra goodies from Vim itself, you can always pipe it there and then read through.
Since Bat, which is my cat replacement, I'll also link to that below, it also features as a pager. So here's what happens when it reads std in. It shows the data in pages that I can move around with Vim arrows, jump just as in Vim with Control U or D for up and down, even jump to the top or the bottom with GG or Shift G respectively. Doing the same with less is exactly the same experience, minus the line numbers and some other Bat features. That said, you have less pretty much everywhere, and Bat is something you have to actively install, so just be mindful of that. It's important to say that when Vim is needed, it's mostly available. If not, just use the local package manager to get it, and you can always send the data pipe directly to Vim, where it's easier to search and replace a specific word like start, for example, with something else. Vim gives you the ease of being flexible enough to only pick a certain area to make changes in, and much more. But this isn't a Vim tutorial, it's just an important reminder that it's there when all else fails, and it's easy to save the final result in a file which I can later then read into other tools or handle myself.
So up until now we dealt with data, sometimes structured, sometimes not structured, but it was text. What if you have real data, real structured data in the sense that you have tables and relations between different columns? Well, what if you have that and you want a Swiss Army knife that can do the same thing we can do for JQ and YQ for table-based data? Awk is one of those tools that takes a course to master. But here, again, we'll focus on the 20% you need to know to achieve 80% of tasks. You only need to know one flag, and in this case, not one flag, but one feature.
Awk's most widely used feature is its ability to print and handle fields. If you remember just one thing from this video, take this syntax of printing a field or two, add a comma to separate, and don't forget to wrap in single quotes and some curly brackets. Once you have that stored, here's where it gets even cooler. Awk can take a field and filter results based on a certain metric, like a number comparison, for example. So, if you want to grep all the names that have more than 200s in their second value field, I can write the comparison like so and have Awk provide the results. I'm sure you can imagine a huge CSV with hundreds of lines and how amazing Awk can be by instantly filtering exactly what you need. Here's the exactly same statement, ran with 300 as the value so you can compare to the source data to the right.
Cut is one of those tools that you can find anywhere. It's really easy to use and it's almost a crime not to know, so you want to have it in your toolbox. Essentially what it does, it's taking a text and cuts it based on a delimiter. Again, all you need to know is just one flag to cut something based on a delimiter, takes it and use it as you see fit.
Our trick is to learn one thing but do it right. Cut needs an input, a delimiter, and a field. That's all. Let's pipe in some data, use space as a delimiter, and read the first field of the source file to the right. You can grab as many fields as you want. There's always the option of changing up delimiters to your choice, even if it doesn't make much sense in the example here. Cut is simple, it's always there, just put it in your toolbox and remember the one important flag, or two in this case.
Okay, wait, everything I just shared will be completely useless without mastering vMotions. Make sure you got these in the video right here. Thank you for watching and I will see you on the next video.